Honestly, no. Honestly, no. And if he had held out for so long, I think it's not because of his only because of his brilliance, but the mistakes of the international community. There were serious miscalculations and wishful thinking. And by the way, the press played along with this, pretending that Assad will be gone in 3 months. Assad must go. We kept repeating it, as if you keep saying Assad must go, the next day he'll be gone. But the balance of forces on the ground was such that was simply not going to happen, and it needed cold and serious thinking and calculation.
Was this the tipping point where you realized that you had to give up?
First of all, when I took the job, I told them it's an impossible job, but it can be done if I have the sustained support of the Security Council. And if they spoke with one voice and were united, because if they are not, it becomes very difficult to deal with. That didn't come. The sustained support and the unity wasn't there. And then when we got to this, which I thought was an opportunity for them to build on this, and they let it drop, I decided it was time for me to move on, because honestly, you refer to me as a peacemaker and a mediator. The mediator cannot want peace more than the protagonist or the Security Council that gave him the job. If they are not behind you, you can't do much. In fact, somebody asked me, why did you quit? I said, I lost my troops on the way to Damascus. Stayed in New York.
I mean, today things are even more complicated. You had Assad as a main player. Now you have so many.
Yeah.
Many groups, and of course you have the ISIS, and they won't even sit at any table.
No, you're right. I mean, things were much better in 2012. In 2012, I was able to sit with Assad and his team and come up with a 6-point plan. Today is absolutely hopeless. Some people tell you there are about 1,000 different groups in addition to the government. And of course, you have all this outside. So whom do you bring to the table? Recently, I've seen meetings between countries which had not spoken to each other for a while. And I hope that this is an indication that they are coming to the point when they realize there is a common danger. Assad probably did not wake them up, but ISIS has woken everybody up. They all know it's a common danger, and everyone could be hurt. I use the European example after the 30-year war, where the countries and the people realized that this war is destroying the whole region and you can't go on forever. And they came together and had the Treaty of Westphalia. I hope we can get them to have their Westphalia moment and do something about the conflict.
You are very famous for your optimism. You've always characterized yourself as an optimist. Stubborn optimism. are you still? Are you an optimist in this situation?
I am an optimist in the sense that no war lasts forever. No conflict lasts forever. Historically, when we look around, whether it's in Europe, Asia, Latin America, or Africa, so it will have to end sometime. When and how it ends is what we should be focused on. And what we can do to accelerate the end is also very crucial. And so I am optimistic in the sense that we will find a solution. And I think if we all work together along the lines I have suggested, we should be able to find a solution. But if we remain divided and each side is supporting one side or the other, expecting their side to win, but I hope by now everyone has realized that their side is not going to win. And even if their side wins, what have they won? A destroyed country with no economy, with half the population displaced, refugees or migrants. Why would you want to destroy a country before you lead it? You know, it's an incredible thing. But I think the end will come. As I said, I can't tell you when. But apart from that, You know, the world is made up of two sets of people, optimist and pessimist. The optimists always die happier.
which one are you?
Both.
I mean, Kofi essentially deals in the politics of dignity. You hear him speak and, you know, the voice is soporific and you're lulled into this world of possibility and optimism. And then comes the 12-point program. That's too boring to read, so you just sign it. But it is devastatingly effective. I've seen it so often, you just kind of go, and he's there like this, and I just want to punch them. You know? And so he brings to these pits of inhumanity, he brings the better voice of ourselves. And they don't understand what he's saying. The people he talks to are pigs. And yet he shakes their hand and he smiles and says, you're looking wonderful and great to see you again. It's a brilliant, brilliant trick of intelligence.
You want to comment on that?
It's impossible to comment. I'm wondering how I can crawl out of here after that.
You're in Sweden with your wife,
Nan.
Yeah. She is she's actually the niece of Raoul Wallenberg.
That's correct. Yeah.
Very important figure in helping refugees during the war. Is that an inspiration for you?
I think he should be inspiration for all of us. I mean, he did a lot in Hungary, saved thousands of Jews without thinking much about the risk to himself. And in the end, when he went to see the Russian delegation to discuss the future of Jews in Hungary and reconstruction, we never saw him again. So for 70 years now, he's been gone. His last letter to the family, the last line said, kiss the little one for me. And the little one was my wife, Nan. Mm. And that little one is 970. And the family has been searching for information, wanting to know what happened, if they can get the remains to bury him, to bring it to closure, and if he's alive, where he is. And during my own career, when I've had the chance, I've spoken to some of the Russian leaders, but nothing has really worked so far. But the search continues.
Tell me, your wife is very often traveling with you. Mm-hmm. Can you describe her importance in your life and work?
No, she's been very, very part of my work. In fact, she's not only my wife and my love, she's a partner. We travel together, and sometimes she has even better programs than I have, because I go and talk to these heads of states from the airport to conference rooms, and they would arrange a program for her where she goes to the villages and see what is happening, visit AIDS patients, women's groups, and others. And then when she comes back, we share information, and sometimes it's very effective. At a presidential or prime minister's dinner, she will say, oh, by the way, I went to this village, and the women need so and so. And as you know, she speaks very softly. Mm. And
in the family, Kofi.
And gets a message across. I don't think I could have done it without her. She's a real partner and a very effective one.
Kofi Annan, thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you.